开会嘅时间到咧。
Members, good afternoon. We're formed a quorum and it's also the appointed time. I call the meeting to order. Now, because we need to vote on items today, so please do not change another seat after the meeting has started. Information papers issued since the last meeting, we have none. Second item is items for discussion for the next meeting. The next meeting is scheduled for the 25th of July, Tuesday at 2:30. The administration has got three proposals for us. One, PWP item number 9370WF, improvement works to water supply in low-lying areas in Central District. And second, PWP item 9374WF, improvement works to water works, first batch of priority water works to be dealt with. And the second item is work of the Urban Renewal Authority and three, annual report on implementation progress of heritage conservation initiatives. Members, do you agree that there will be the three items to discuss at the next meeting? Any other suggestions? If not, that will be the items of our next meeting. We move on to the third item on the agenda, and that is PWP item number 469CL, Kai Tak Development Infrastructure at North Apron Area of Kai Tak Airport. Let us welcome from the administration Mr. Roger Wong, Deputy Secretary from Development Bureau, and his team. I'm sure we've all got the attendance list. May I remind members that this item is a funding proposal. Please note that in accordance with ROP 83A, if you have a direct or indirect pecuniary interest in any of the item, please disclose the nature of the interest involved before you speak. Will members who intend to speak press the request to speak button? Thank you. Yes. Dears, you have prepared a PowerPoint presentation for us. Would you like to introduce the paper to us first? Thank you. About 100 hectares, one-third of the Kai Tak development area is open space to provide open space and landscaped areas to the neighborhood and to tie with the residential and commercial developments of the district. We propose to upgrade part of number 469CL to Cat A at money of the day prices of $368.5 million. The proposed project is located at the North Apron area of the former Kai Tak Airport near Olympic Avenue, will provide open space, and it will also be a linkage between the Kai Tak Station Square and also the Kai Tak Development Area, and that will enhance the connectivity and accessibility of the site. My colleague will give a short PowerPoint presentation of the project, and we welcome questions from members afterwards. Yes, Mr. Mack. Thank you, Chair. We would like to present to members proposed open space development at the North Apron area of the former Kai Tak Airport. Now, in the green area here, we have three adjoining open spaces, OS 5, OS 3B, and OS 4. And then to the right, near Kai Tak Station and Kai Tak River, we have open space OS 6. The pink area is where we have the Kai Tak Station Square. And we've also got Prince Edward East. And further north, they have Kowloon City and Sam Po Kong. The proposed open spaces will be connected to the Kai Tak Station Square. So we have a coherent piece of open space. In future, people from San Pokong can make use of the elevated walkway of Prince Edward Road East and also the pedestrian subway of San Pokong to access the open space here. So we can enhance the connectivity of pedestrians for the residential development here, and we can also enhance the accessibility for people living in San Pokong and Kowloon City. Now, this is the current status of OS3B, OS4, and OS5, and to the right, we have the proposed open space. The area will be for future public housing and private housing development. It's also close to the Kai Tak station, so people can use the elevated walkway of Prince Edward East as well as the pedestrian subway to access the various residential developments in Kai Tak, and can also access the Kai Tak station. This is OS6, how it looks now, and the open space is next to the comprehensive development area and also the Kai Tak Station Square. There will be an elevated walkway to be constructed so that in between San Pokong and Kai Tak area, we can have connectivity. OS3B, OS4, and OS5 cover thematic landscape areas, a leisure area, and a multi-purpose area. And there will also be pedestrian walkways connecting the Kai Tak Station Square and housing developments. There will be various universal accesses to different places within the area to make it easy for users. This is how it looks from the southwest. This is how OS3B, OS4, and OS5 will look in the future. As regards the scope of OS6, there will be a thematic landscaped area, a multi-purpose area, an observation deck, and also a greenway for shared use by pedestrians and cyclists. There will be pedestrian walkways connecting the Kai Tak Station Square and CDA, and a footbridge connecting both sides of Kai Tak River, as well as ancillary facilities including toilets, a storeroom, and a park office. There will also be universal accesses for other users to link up with the Kai Tak Station Square. This is how OS6 will look from the southeast. We propose different trees to be planted there to provide shade and a pleasant environment for future users. We're going to plant flowering plants such as bohemia and sphaethodia, etc. So though the landscaped area will look different in different seasons, we're going to apply for funding from the Finance Committee upon approval by PWSC. Thank you. I now open the floor to members. Four members have indicated the intention to speak. Five. Dr. Chang Meng Kwong, Dr. Lo Wai Kwok, Mr. Andrew Lam, Mr. Lau Kok Fan, and Mr. Stanley Ng. 4 minutes each, including questions and answers. Dr. Chang Meng Kwong. Thank you, Chair. This is really a valuable site, and it has been long sought after, and I think the layout looks good. However, given that there are both residential and private developments here, and there is also a river there. In South Korea, in Taiwan, usually on river banks, they will have a very pleasant landscape design so that they can be photogenic spots. Can we organize a competition for the design of the river banks. Given that there is a Kai Tak River here, I don't know about the water quality of the river. Can we have water-related activities here? And you're going to build greenway for shared use by cyclists and pedestrians. It will be completed in 3 years' time. But I think it takes much longer for the whole of Kai Tak development area to be completed. So how can you ensure users' safety? After all, there will be the elderly and children and cyclists using the area. Lastly, you plan to have major events as well as exhibitions here. The place has residential developments nearby. How can you ensure the there is no conflict between these two group of users? Mr. Wong, indeed, we have devoted some special thinking to the thematic landscaped areas. Now, for the planting future plants, the place will look differently in different seasons. Now, in spring, we have the bohemia, variegator, and in winter, we will again have another kind of bohemia, etc. For the Kai Tak River, in 2010-11, we had a public engagement exercise and also a design competition in 2014. We have been engaging the district councils very closely in order to take on board their views. When it comes to the greenway for shared use by pedestrians and cyclists, this is not the first of its kind in Hong Kong. In WKCD, there is a similar greenway. But Dr. Chow is very correct in saying that safety is of paramount importance. After all, pedestrians and cyclists are going to use the greenway together. So we will have a three-tier management structure. First, we will have rules for using the area. It has statutory effect. Management staff will advise against behavior that contravene the rules. Failing that, there may be a prosecution. We will have various signages and markings on the road, on the greenway, so as to segregate pedestrians and cyclists. So while there is no physical segregation, we will have markings on the road to ensure that there is separation, and we will have signs to enhance people's safety awareness. We will have do's and don'ts signs set up there to promote mutual respect for the regulations and rules. We will discuss with district councils to incorporate their views where appropriate. What about traffic arrangements? Water-related activities at Kai Tak River. There will be three lookout points there with a terraced design so that people can get close to the water. I hasten to add that this is a main drainage area for East Kowloon. The catchment area covers as far as Chi Wan San and Chok Yun. In the case of a rainstorm, the water current and water volume can rise quite substantially. So we're going to have railings to ensure that users can enjoy the area safely. What about traffic management, signs and exhibitions, etc.?
Okay.
These are things that members are concerned about. Thank you. Dr. Chow expressed his expectation for this project. We are trying to make the project pleasant for the users. So other than passive activities, such as the landscaped area, there will be active activities included in the project as well. Activities will be organized for members of the public. There will also be toilets and drinking fountains to cater to the needs of the public. Thank you. Next, Dr. Lo Wai-kwong. Thank you. Regarding this works proposal of an open space area, of course, I support that. In this area, there are going to be public and private housing developments and other facilities, including the Kai Tak Sports Park, hospitals, schools, and the cruise terminal. So this area has lots of diverse facilities, and it is going to be a landmark in the Kowloon district. So it is essential to have good open spaces and amenities. I'm going to talk about the Kai Tak Environmentally Friendly Link. Since the old airport is being developed into a comprehensive development area, at the time, suggestions were made regarding an environmentally friendly link to connect this strip with other public transport interchanges in East Kowloon. I have participated in this project. Years before I joined the LegCo, I served as a professional in public consultation processes. I discussed this project with other surveyors and engineers. We are not just talking about monorail systems. There can be other choices. We need to see which one is the best alternative. At the time, I thought that we would go ahead with it. But after going through the motion, but a few years ago, I think in 2020, the project was put on hold. And the administration explained to us why that was the case. And I was quite disappointed. The transport plan proposed was a bus network and minibus networks. Lately, there have been discussions regarding this system again. Perhaps it is because we went to the GBA to look at the Sky Shuttle. Dr. Lo, you have talked about transportation issues a lot, but today we are the panel on development meeting. Well, you can't have development without transportation. So, well, you should talk about this in a transport panel. Well, you have stopped members from speaking irrelevant topics many times, so I'll see if the DS has anything to respond regarding this topic. As we all know, today we are here to talk about the open space. Transportation is perhaps one of the aspects in the open space, so I'll see if you have anything to respond. Well, I thank Dr. Lo for his support. Just then I talk about the connectivity of these open spaces. And I understand that there has been discussion in recent months. Perhaps I'll invite colleagues from the CEDD to respond. Mr. Mac,
thank you. Perhaps I'll provide some information
regarding the diverse transportation system. There are five elements, including e-minibuses and pedestrian linkages connecting Kowloon Bay and the old airport area, and connecting the elevated walkways connecting Kai Tak and Kun Tong, and water taxis. So earlier, funding was granted by LegCo for the elevated observation deck. As for the network regarding the two action areas, consultants were engaged to come up with proposals, which will be presented to LegCo later. We are trying to come up with a detailed design. As for the greenway, the first section of the greenway, which is some 7.5 kilometers long, will be open later this year. We are keeping an eye on the latest development of green transports around the world, especially the ones on the mainland, to ensure efficiency and sustainability of transportation network in the area. Thank you. Next, Mr. Andrew Lam. Thank you, Chair. I have two questions. First, well, the climate is changing rapidly. So I would like to know that if you have included enough shaded areas in the open spaces for the public to stay cool under the sun or in the rain. Second, regarding the greening system in the Kai Tak area, this is only a small component. So I would like to know this. Kai Tak Sports Park is expected to be completed by 2025. And near Song Wong Toi Station, some ancient relics were discovered, so I'm not sure when that will be completed. But these are important when it comes to the appeal of the Kai Tak area. In the future, if this area is more pleasant, then you will have better results at land sale. So I would like to know when these projects will be completed. Deputy Secretary. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Lam. There are two areas of concern. Firstly, we are aware that we need to provide shading for the public since this is an open space, and we do have to provide enough drinking fountains. In total, there will be 350 seats along the open space. 160 of them are under shades. They may be covered, or seats may be provided or installed under large trees. Upon completion of the open space, if there is public demand, then we will be able to add more seating under the trees. As for Mr. Lam's second question, this open space covers 100 hectares. There are three themes. The first one is waterfront promenade, accounting for 26% of the area, that is 26 hectares. Then there is a passive open space, that is this one, 13 hectares. The rest, multi-purpose areas such as parks, squares, etc. Currently, we have completed 19% of the open space, including the Kun Tong Waterfront Park, other waterfront promenades opposite to the Children's Hospital, Kun Tong Action Area, and some sky garden in Kai Tak. There will also be phase two of the station square. Hoi Sam Park in Kai Tak, another park, Song Wong Toi Park, and along the old runway. So the whole system will be completed in phases. Well, is it possible for you to give us more details regarding the green system, as mentioned by Dr. Lam, the completion date? Because we are concerned about the consistency of the Kai Tak development area. Can you give us more details? If you can't give us more details now, perhaps you can supplement after the meeting so that we can monitor the progress. We need to monitor the progress to ensure that there is consistency. Deputy Secretary, you are welcome to give us more details now, but it would be perhaps better for you to provide us with a written submission, including the maps and layout plans, etc. Well, shaded areas are very important. If you are providing covered seat areas, so will you consider installing solar panels to power fans to provide a cooler environment for people sitting there? I haven't really seen such facilities. Deputy Secretary, anything to add? Well, regarding the completion dates, we are going to provide the completion date for each facility after the meeting. Chairman, I would like to know for the whole system, how many government departments are involved, especially for the management. Please provide us with the details later. As for the other question, well, we do have solar panels installed on top of the seats, and we will definitely consider Chairman's suggestions. Thank you. Next, Mr. Lau Kwok Fan.
Thank you, Chair.
Ms. Starry LEE is very concerned about this project in Kai Tak. I understand that she has issued a letter to the panel, and she has asked me to ask questions on her behalf. We would like to know when there will be plans for OS6A. Residents of Kai Tak would like to see this project start as soon as possible along both sides of OS6A. Residents have started moving in, and when they are heading towards or from the MTR station, they will walk past the Riverside Park. So this park is a very important public facility. So how will the administration address the residents' demands? When will there be planning for OS6A? And a more specific question, is it possible to pass OS6A to the CEDD for planning and construction? In OS3B, OS4, and OS6, in the layout plan, there is already consideration given to OS6A. How come the planning is now being entrusted to LCSD instead of CEDD? And even though works have not started, is it possible to open up the area so that residents will find it easier to go from one side of the river to the other? Thank you.
Deputy Secretary, thank you, Chair, for your questions. We note Ms. Starry Lee's view on the design of OS6A. I thank her for her valuable suggestion. The LCSD has got a blueprint for development of recreational and sports facilities, which has reviewed every few years to take forward related projects. We do understand that members of the public are anxious that OS6A should be open to the public for their use as early as possible. So CE and ED will come up with a simple interim solution. We will have benches and sitting areas and also a cycling path, the footpaths, etc. for early commissioning. So it will be completed in the form of a minor works project. We are happy to take views from members of the public and legislators. As regards the division of labor between the CE and ED and LCSD, because it is an open space, it falls under the portfolio of leisure and cultural services facilities. So the LCSD will be responsible for the project. But if it is about connectivity, then CE and ED has a role to play. This time, we have taken on those open spaces. And as for OS6A, LCSD has got pedestrian precincts, and so connectivity is already addressed there. Still, we understand that members of the public would like to use OS6A as early as possible, so we will have a simple interim solution. Any supplements from LCSD? Because everyone hopes to see a good design. That's the main purpose. And to this end, members have proposed that you run a competition, a design competition. So what is your response to this? As mentioned by the Deputy Secretary, we will have short-term measures so as to open the site to the public as soon as possible. So we will open up the space first and improve it afterwards. We want to strike a balance, given that we are going to have an interim design. We don't want to put in features that will be substantially altered in the future. So we will try to improve the environment as far as possible, and we will consult stakeholders and provide the necessary facilities for a park that will be included in the feasibility study. I thank CNED. I understand that the site can be made available for use in the short term. So please let us know the timetable and when it can be opened to the public. Deputy Secretary, when you provide the supplementary information paper, please include this bit of information, okay? Mr. Stanley Ng. Thank you, Chair. I have two concerns. First is about the underground shopping area. As can be seen in the paper, the administration hasn't given up the idea of providing an underground shopping area under the two stations. I'd like to know the timetable for the features. And as for the construction of the four open spaces, will there be underground shopping areas? Will space reserved for construction of such facilities so that we don't need to have a repeated road openings leading to waste of time and resources? The second concern is about waste disposal. A matter of environmental protection. According to the paper, about 16% of the non-inlet construction waste will be dumped at landfills. For this 1,390 tons of non-inlet construction waste, what is the respective percentage of waste, because according to the EPD, that could include timber and packaging material. So what are the components of this 1,390 tons of non-inert construction waste? How much will be plants? How much will be timber? Will they be transported to Wai Park in Tuen Mun? Because yard waste can be dealt with there at Wai Park. But there is no mention of how such waste will be disposed of. Can we be given an account? Thank you, Deputy Secretary. Thank you, Chair, and Mr. Ng for your questions. The first is underground shopping areas. It is 1,500 kilometers in length, half the length of Nathan Road. At various sections, we're going to provide such a feature, and there will be linkages among them. The first to be commissioned is the 400-meter underground shopping street near Kai Tak Station. It will be completed within this year because of the CDA. For the remaining 1,100 kilometers, they will be commissioned in the coming few years, all the way until 2029. When it comes to the two open spaces, they will be linked to the future underground shopping streets. We will ensure that there is linkage between them so that we don't have to open up the road again. Usually, in public works projects, we require the contractor to submit a proposal to recycle and reuse construction waste as far as possible. Now, this is an open space project, so it is a bit difficult to reuse the waste, but it will be used in other public work projects. For the 16% of non-inert construction waste, I defer to CNED on the relative components in it. Now, most of it will be weeds, as well as waste generated from construction. They do not have any reuse value, so it will be transported to our landfills. Will it be sent to our Wai Park? We can discuss with the EPD later. So you will reuse and recycle as far as possible. You may not be able to reuse it on site. You can use it elsewhere. And failing that, I am afraid the waste has to be dumped at our landfills. Dr. Wendy Hong, let me declare interest. The company I work for is involved in some of the projects at KTD area. Now there will be public light housing, the Longchun Zone Bridge Conservation Project, and also underground shopping street. Some are a grade, some are underground, and they will be completed at different times. I'd like to know the management and administration of such facilities in the future. If they are done by different contractors, then it may be hard to coordinate. There is also the conservation of Longchun Stone Bridge. We have to be very careful with that project. I'd like to know which department will follow up on the coordination of these different places. And according to your paper, there is no heritage implications, when in fact, Kai Tak carries the collective memories of Hong Kong people. It used to be the Kai Tak Airport because it's relevant to Ho Kai and Ho Tak, and the area forms precious collective memory of Hong Kong. Will you use the historical background of the place as the theme for future development of the park? Now we are told that Kai Tak will be like a famous scenic river spot in Japan. This place carries a lot of memories for us. It was recorded in the history of Qing Dynasty. It's an important site in Kowloon. So will you consider using the history of the area to be the theme of the park? Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you, Dr. Hong, for your questions. I will defer to the SE and ED for coordination among the different projects. Secondly, given the rich historical background of Kai Tak, how can we record its history in our public open space? Take the Station Square as an example. We will have a display of old pictures. There will be a historical promenade or corridor. Kai Tak has 100 hectares of open space. We have to give each piece of open space a unique characteristic. For the open spaces in question, they are passive in nature to offer leisure facilities to the public. I believe LCSD will think about the unique feature of our open spaces, and it will try to preserve the history of Kai Tak as far as possible. Mr. Young, thank you. With regard to the sports park, now, the area is as big as 300 odd hectares. Who is responsible for coordination? We have a Kai Tak office with a commissioner responsible for the coordination among different projects to ensure that there is no conflict, and then all the projects will be taken forward progressively in an orderly manner. Dr. Hong referred to Hokkai and Aotek, and also archaeological features such as the Longchun River. I'm pleased to tell you that in late June, there will be an underground subway from Shekulung Road to Kai Tak. If members are interested, we can ask the commissioner to arrange for members a visit to the new pedestrian subway so that you can understand the work of the Kai Tak office. I remember that in the last term of the council, there was very detailed presentation on conservation of Kai Tak. We are happy to know that we can see the work of the government on site. May I draw members' attention to one piece of information. We received a submission from Ms. Starry LEE yesterday. It has already been circularized to members. The paper has also been referred to the administration. Can I invite the Deputy Secretary to give us a simple response to this submission? First, it mentioned public hygiene and also pests and mosquitoes. Can you give us a short response, please? The facilities in Kai Tak will be open to the public in the future. There is also the Kai Tak Sports Park. We are going to host an event of the National Games, All China National Games. And we'd like to know whether there will be impact on residents. Have you considered that? And the temporary, there is a temporary linkage for the two sides of Kai Tak River, but is not adequate. Will the secretary please address this point?
I'm also concerned about the construction period in paragraph 13 of the paper. It mentioned noise control. Well, currently you use quiet equipment and acoustic linings or shields. Has the government conducted any tests to see that with the adoption of these measures, what type of noise level will there be? Deputy Secretary, thank you. We have received Ms. Starry Lee's letter regarding the mosquito or pest issue. As I said, we will be pushing ahead with the OS6A project. There will be some drainage works to be done, and that will remove the problem of stagnant water. And the RCSD will be responsible for the management of the area, which should help with the pest problem. As for the accessibility, the two proposed projects here today will increase the connectivity of the area within the Kai Tak development area. Different sections of the greenway will be commissioned in phases, and the greenway will connect different scenic spots along Kai Tak. As for the construction period and the noise level, we use silencer, mufflers, and acoustic linings and shields. So the noise level will not be high since we are doing excavation and planting, etc. In the past, we have hotlines for members of the public to call should there be a noise problem. We try to minimize any noise nuisance. Well, please make a written response to Ms. Starry Lee's letter. Okay, if members have no other questions, I would like to know if members support the submission of this paper to the PWSC. Any objection? If there is none, that means that we all support the proposal. So this proposal will be submitted to the PWSC for their consideration. Thank you. This concludes this agenda item. I thank the administration for attending the meeting. We'll now go to the next agenda item. I invite government representatives to join us. Members who wish to speak, please press the request to speak button. Perhaps I'll go through the list of members waiting to speak. There are currently 8 members on the list, including Ms. Chen Yuming, Mr. Michael Tian, Dr. Chow Meng Kong, Mr. Lau Kwok Fan, Dr. Lo Wai Kwok, Mr. Chen Hock Fong, Mr. Bill Tang, and Mr. Andrew Lam. Well, I welcome the Secretary for Development for attending this meeting, and I welcome her team as well. I won't introduce them one by one. The attendance list has been emailed to members. Secretary, will you walk us through the paper first? I understand that there is a PowerPoint presentation as well. Secretary, Chairman, members, currently we have a waterworks ordinance in place regulating all registered consumer and make it clear that they can only recover from the users the water charges paid to the water supplies department. But in the past, during enforcement actions, there have been difficulties in evidence collection. That is why we would like to amend the Waterworks Ordinance to provide officers with more enforcement authority. The amendment will cover all the users, but in reality, after the ordinance is amended, it will help subdivided unit tenants from being overcharged when it comes to their water charges paid to their landlords. So the target of our amendment exercise is that we would like to draft an amendment bill as quickly as possible, and when legislative session resumes in October, the amendment bill can be submitted to LegCo for scrutiny. Right now, I'll invite the Director of Water Supplies to walk us through the amendment. Mr. Yao. Thank you, Chairman. Members, I will now walk members through the Waterworks Amendment Bill 2023 with a PowerPoint presentation. The Water Facilities Regulations was amended on the 14th of May 2021. It clearly states that occupants, registered consumer can only recover from the occupants the water charge paid to the water supplies department, and any violation will lead to a fine at level 3 that is $10,000. However, it does not empower enforcement officials to collect documents from the complainants or from the related parties. We have received 92 complaint cases, and among them, 8 of them were successfully brought for prosecution and conviction. 15 cases are still under investigation. For the remaining 69 cases, since there is no legislation to compel them to provide evidence, very often the tenants are not willing to provide statements or to become witnesses. So due to insufficient evidence, we cannot prosecute the related parties. So that is why, since currently there is no powers for law enforcement officers to obtain documents and information, so we propose empowering the water authority to provide the relevant information. Any person who without reasonable excuse fails to comply with the request, they are committing an offense, a fine at level 3, that is $10,000, with a further fine of $1,000 per day after the designated period for not providing the requested information. And second, although we did see some successful prosecution and conviction, we still feel that there needs to be a more deterrent effect, so we propose a two-tier system. For the first conviction, they will be fined a level 3 fine that is $10,000. For the second or subsequent convictions, we propose to increase one more level of fine at level 4 that is $25,000. And we also propose to add a new provision that the court may order any person convicted of water overcharging to repay to the payer the overcharged money. third, our last suggestion. The WSD and the Rating and Valuation Department conduct inspections, and we do organize joint inspections as well. And under the Landlord and Tenant Consolidation Ordinance, it covers overcharging for utility services. So very often, offender of this ordinance is also violating the Waterworks Ordinance. So we propose exchanging information between WSD and the RVD. They can share information on water overcharging cases. If the RVD identified any related cases, they can pass the information to us for follow-up action, and it is the same vice versa. If we discover that that offences are being committed under the Waterworks Regulation and the Landlord and Tenant Consolidation Ordinance, we will refer the case back to RVD. We hope that we can get members' support on this proposal. Thank you. First, Ms. Chen Yuming, 4 minutes, question and answer included. I speak in support of the amendment proposal to enhance the law enforcement authority under the Waterworks Ordinance. So this proposal is a follow-up on the amendment made in 2022 against overcharging of utility services. And according to the proposal, it is said that documents and information have to be provided to the relevant authorities, such as tenancy agreement, receipt, water bill, etc. However, I would like the administration to think about services provided for users living in SDUs. For users or people who are occupying government land or brownfield illegally, regulations should be imposed on them. I'm sure that the administration is aware of illegal brownfield operation in the new territories. I hope that the ordinance can target not only SDUs but also illegal occupation of government land. Owners or tenants who apply for water services have to be the registered users. Otherwise, the government should reserve the right to cut off their water services. If the government stepped up supervision, I'm sure that the illegal occupation situation in the new territories can be mitigated. I understand that under this amendment, my suggestions may not be incorporated, but I would like the administration to note my suggestion and consider it seriously. Thank you. Secretary. Well, Ms. Chen talked about illegal occupation of government land and violation of lease conditions. We do have other ordinances or legislations in place to regulate these matters. Under the Waterworks Ordinance, in the installation of water meters, is it possible for us to cut off water services when we discover any illegal activities? Perhaps I'll invite the Director of Water Supplies to give a response. Thank you. Well, first, I would like to thank Ms. Chen for her support of the amendment. Ms. Chen talked about illegal occupation of land and use of water. If we receive a complaint, we will conduct inspection. We'll see if any applications were made to us. We are concerned about water safety. Very often, the waterworks are not connected properly, and that may affect the public system. We do conduct enforcement actions. We issue warning letters and ask them to rectify the situation. If these instructions are not followed, we may suspend their water services.
Follow up from Ms. Chen. Yes, you have got complaints, but it's rather desirable that people can continue to occupy the site to operate there illegally for 8-10 years. So, Mr. Yao, what if it involves illegal occupation of government land? I've got cases, but I don't want to name them here. Now, if there is illegal occupation of land and yet there is application for water meter to be established, well, if they want to do that, they have to submit a design plan and also the connection, water pipe connections, and we have to vet those plans before we accept an application. You can pass on your information to the director afterwards. You have to be more stringent. If it is not the landowner, you should not approve its application. Yes, please follow up if you have cases. Mr. Michael Tian, thank you. The purpose of the amendment is to help the SDU tenants so that it may not be overcharged. However, you have received 92 complaints and you've only got 8 convictions. I understand that the main reason was because tenants were not willing to be witness. They were worried that they would suffer revenge from the landlords afterwards. So I'd like to know whether the conviction rate has been 100%. Can you want an answer first? Chair, yes, I mentioned 8 cases. There were cases where the complainants were ready to come forward to be witnesses. That means if they're willing to give evidence, then conviction can always be successful. In other words, if the tenants in all these 92 cases are willing to be witnesses, then you can get successful conviction as well. But then tenants are worried that the owners of SDUs may then raise rent, etc. So I support your proposed amendment. I hope there is no need for the tenant to come out to give evidence. One of the amendments involve requiring relevant persons to give you the tenancy document, receipt, water bill, etc. Now, I'd like to put myself in the shoes of property owners. Now, if because of one SDU tenant, you want him to give you the whole tenancy agreement, you can ask the ILD. Why don't you just require the document from the ILD and then for internal circulation, you can use it for whatever purpose you want. And there is no mention in this amendment how tenants should share the water charges because the SDU sizes might differ and the number of the size of households may differ. So you're saying that so long as the total sum of water charges do not exceed the relevant bill amount, that is okay. Then perhaps you should specify the way the water charges are calculated on the basis of the household size or what. Now, if the owner decides not to charge one or two of the SDUs or maybe the occupant is a relative, etc., then it's chaotic. And in past conviction cases, the fines ranged from $1,000 to $5,000. Now, have you considered raising the fine for subsequent convictions to $50,000? Then this will serve a greater deterrent effect. Can I have a response? Secretary, there are 3 questions. First, must we ask the landlord for the tenancy agreement, we can get it from the ILD. We want to reserve the right to require such information to be produced by the landlord, because the ILD may not have all the tenancy agreements. And Mr. Tian asked whether the government can come up with a way for sharing the water charges so as to avoid disputes. I think the best approach is for each and every SDU tenant to have a separate water meter. But we have not gone so far in this amendment exercise because we do not want to bother members of the public. The main thing is to penalize the offenders. In old buildings, it may not be possible for water meters to be installed separately. That's why I didn't mention that, said Mr. Tian. Now, we have not proposed any formula, because even if we put in place a formula, there can still be dispute, because the size of an SDU may not have a direct impact on the water consumption, not even the household size. It all depends on the consumption habit of the tenants concerned. So we're thinking of a way that can quickly enhance the enforcement power of our officers. So how can you ensure that one or two SDU will not be overcharged? The main thing is the total amount of water charges received will not exceed the relevant bill amount. We do have a charging rate. If the charging rate is higher than the rate set by the water supplies department, that is already a contravention of the regulation or ordinance that is already approved. And why have we not make the fine for subsequent convictions heavier? This is because there need to be internal relativity when it comes to the levels of fine. And we have sought legal advice, and we are of the view that fine at level 4 for subsequent convictions is appropriate. All right, you don't want to interfere. You can have three different criteria: the size, the rent, as well as the household size. Well, as said by the secretary, anything can be open to dispute. The most important thing is whether it is reasonable. Either you look at the size of the SDU, the household size, or the etc. Well, the consumption pattern is also important. Some people do not have any water saving sense. All right, I don't want to argue with you. I'd like to ask the administration whether you can seek relevant information from the ILD, not before the proposed amendment here. And then, according to the secretary, ILD may not possess all the information you need, and therefore you can require such information from the landlord. Is that correct? Yes, that is already clarified. Dr. Jiaming Kwong. Thank you, President. It's really disgusting to overcharge the grassroots water charges. So I support the proposal. It is necessary. But the current fine is around $10,000 to $20,000. This is not, it cannot deter such offenses. And look at the figures. You've got 92 complaint cases. Close to 70 of those cases could not be prosecuted because there was insufficient information or evidence from complainants. Perhaps it's because tenants did not want to be evicted for the extra few hundred dollars charged for water consumption. perhaps you can state in the bill that if within 12 to 6 months after a complaint, the complainant is evicted, then you can impose a fine of up to $100,000. Because if the ordinance is toothless, then it's useless. Thirdly, regardless of our discussion in the council, the most important thing is the effect in the real market. So can you discuss with real estate agents when the tenancy agreements are signed, then landlords and tenants should be reminded of the relevant regulations. Lastly, it's not really that difficult to solve the problem. I used to live in an SDU when I was a kid, and usually the landlord would ask us to pay a sum arbitrarily, and the secretary told us that so long as the total amount of what the charges received by the landlord doesn't exceed the relevant bill amount. Can you, for some tenancy agreements, they may put a cap on the amount of water to be used. All right, I will defer to my colleague on the proposed fines. And secondly, whether we can enhance the regulation of landlords to the effect that they cannot evict their tenants, otherwise they will be meted out heavier punishment. Actually, after we have raised the penalty level, then the landlord cannot blame the tenant anymore for complaining, because it is the law enforcement agency that require the relevant parties to provide information. I hope this can remove the fear on anxiety on the part of tenants for providing evidence, and whether we will publicize the new arrangements to real estate agents. Yes, the answer is yes. We will remind them to keep all those documents properly. There can be no reasonable excuse for any person to comply with the water authority's requests to have documents produced. Mr. Yao, now we have considered other pieces of legislation, including the Landlord and Tenant Consolidation Ordinance. Now, for the first offense or conviction is $10,000. And then for second and subsequent convictions, we have already moved to level 4, that is $25,000. Now, for those convictions, the one in one case the fine was $5,000, and in two cases $4,000. So sometimes it's not about the penalty level. Rather, we cannot secure a conviction because no one is willing to come out to give evidence. And can it be the case that there are no documents, no records? Now, we require them to keep all the records of water bills, receipts, etc. Failure to produce such documents is already an offense. This will make it easier for us to enforce the regulations, and that will pose a greater deterrence effect.
Next, Mr. Lau Kuo-fen. Thank you, Chairman. I support the Waterworks Amendment Bill. I think that it is unacceptable to overcharge water charges. The water charges have not been raised over the past 3 decades, and yet there were people who overcharge their tenants in SDUs. So I believe that this is an appropriate amendment. There are 3 parts to it. The first one, to empower the Water Services Department to obtain documents and information. Second, increase the penalty. And third, to share information with the Rating and Valuation Department. I agree with all 3 aspects, but I would like to seek some clarifications first. In the past, there were only 8 successful convictions. The number is very small. The reason may be that the tenants were not willing to become witnesses. Of course, you can take proactive action to obtain information. And of course, the complainants will have to submit all the necessary documents. Is it possible for them to submit the documents afterwards? As long as the complainants were not willing to come forward to become witnesses, it is still very difficult for you to prosecute and convict the landlords. And I thank the Secretary for explaining the increase of penalty. There is also a daily fine upon the expiration of the designated period, that is $1,000 per day. I would like to know, how do you designate the period? And upon the expiration of the designated period, if they are still not providing the requested information, what are you going to do? And third, on sharing information with the RVD, will you consider sharing information with other departments as well? Just like what Ms. Chen Yuming said, in new territories, there are illegal occupations going on. When these people apply for a water meter, government departments may be aware of the fact that they are illegally occupying government land. So you may become aware of any contravention of this offense. It is important for government departments to exchange information. Now you are taking the first step. Is it possible for all or more government departments to share information with one another? Secretary, Chairman, on Mr. Lau's first question. If landlords fabricate receipts or records and submit those false documents to the authorities, then the tenants will still have to suffer. Well, I would like to point out that to falsify documents or instruments, it is a serious offense. So if landlords are doing this, they are not only contravening the Water Works Ordinance, they will be breaking other laws. If in extreme cases, tenants are still worried to come forward, then many issues cannot be solved. We do hope that they are willing to come forward. I would like to stress that tenants must not falsify any records or instruments with their landlords. I'm not sure if any landlords are bold enough to ask tenants to falsify documents with them. In future publicity efforts, we will educate the public regarding this. And then on information sharing, in many enforcement actions conducted, let's say lands department or buildings department. These are departments under the Development Bureau. How do they exchange information? Actually, there is an existing mechanism since they are all under the Development Bureau. In the future, for the Water Services Department, we will think about how to share information with them, especially with Lands Department, since this is the department responsible for land management. I do believe that there is a possibility to exchange information with more government departments. As for the $1,000 fine per day and its calculation, I'll invite the director to take that question. Well, first, I thank Mr. Lau for his support. It is very important for them to submit documents on time. So we have drawn reference from other legislations in the submission of relevant documents. If the requested documents are not provided, then there will be a further fine each day. The designated period is not long, perhaps 14 days. If they fail to do so, then first, they are breaking the law, and second, there will be a further fine of $1,000 per day. Next, Dr. Loh Wai Kwong. Thank you. Chairman, I support the amendments of the Water Works Ordinance and the relevant regulations to enhance the law enforcement power of the Water Authority, especially on overcharging water charges. People living in subdivided units are already in dire situations, so to overcharge them means to put more burden on their shoulders. It is mentioned in the paper the arrangements of installing separate or independent water meter. Of course, it would be the fairest to have independent water meters installed. How come this measure has not been effective? I'm not sure if you are able to answer this question, or will colleagues in charge of housing issues be more familiar with this? I just would like to know how come the installation of water meters has not successfully tackled this problem? Is it because they are not willing to install separate water meters, or perhaps one party is willing and the other is not? I thank Dr. Loh for his support. We do feel that we need to step up our efforts in installing separate water meters for the tenants. They may need to pay for the water meters, but in the latest policy address, the government has waived the payment of the water fee deposit that is $400 and the charge for providing a meter that is $120. We have collaborated with NGOs and arranged for volunteers to exchange or to install water meters for these tenants free of charge. However, since the ordinance's effectiveness has been in question, it is not that easy to prosecute or convict the landlords. Sometimes it is not the landlord's intention to overcharge their tenants. If tenants wish to install separate water meters, they can simply call our hotlines. I do agree that more publicity efforts should be put in. Thank you. No follow-up from me, Chairman. I just would like to see enhanced law enforcement actions and publicity efforts to encourage people to install water meters I think that you can start your enhanced publicity efforts now. Thank you. Next, Mr. Chen Hofeng. Thank you, Chen. I can see that the government has put in a lot of efforts in solving the plight of those living in inadequate housing. So we do support the amendment. But in reality, after the law has been amended, how will the law enforcement actions going to complement the amendments? Last time in the subcommittee on issues relating to SDUs, well, let's say in a 2-year tenancy period, 1 year has passed already. 1/5 of the tenancies have official registration. With the amended waterworks ordinance, how are you going to redeploy your manpower to strengthen law enforcement actions? The ordinance is there, but if you don't enforce it, then it is useless. So I would like to hear more about that. You haven't mentioned this in the paper regarding enforcement actions. Will you increase the number of staff members, etc.? I would like to learn more about that. Second, on information exchange between government departments, some other members have asked this question as well. Do you have any information exchange with the buildings department? Very often when buildings department conducts inspection, they are able to gauge which flat is being used as a subdivided flat. So is it possible for them to utilize this ordinance and share information with you, with the RVD? If yes, then the RVD can ask the owner or the landlord to submit a tenancy agreement. If not, then perhaps they are making a false statement. Is it possible for you to take this action to protect SDU's tenant or even to crack down on SDUs? Secretary, in buildings department's enforcement actions, after they visit the premises, of course they will be able to know whether the premises is being used as SDUs. As for any possible information exchange, please allow me to take follow-up action after the meeting with the buildings department. If there is any legislation restriction, I'm sure that we will be able to make amendments to that. How about manpower? Director, thank you. I thank Mr. Chen for his support. Right now, we have a team of 35 staff members ready to take enforcement actions once the amendments come into effect. In the past, there were perhaps 50 cases per year. I'm sure that the number of cases will go up. Among the 92 cases, our colleagues have actually called the complainants one by one. Well, Director, in the past, you have to wait for people to make a complaint. With these 30-something staff members, will you be taking proactive action? Director, well, we have all along been taking proactive action. Together with the RVD, we have conducted inspections after the First Amendment came into effect on the 14th of May. We inspected sometimes the whole building. In the past, we have to ask them to come forward to become witnesses. But after the amendment comes into effect, then we don't have to do that any longer. and we will take action first on more serious cases where the overcharge amount is higher. After members of the public are aware of how easy it is to take enforcement action, hopefully there will be fewer cases.
Mr. Tan Kapiu, the Development Bureau has taken the initiative to amend the Waterworks Ordinance and Regulations to serve a greater deterrent effect. Landlords will be reminded to be law-abiding. There will no longer be the need for tenants to give evidence before prosecution can be instituted. I think this is very good. This is a fair and just way and a very proactive way of tackling the problem. The department will no longer act on complaints, and I think this is a very good move. Now, usually water bills are issued every 4 months, and there is a progressive scale in charging for the use of water. Assuming that the proposal is passed, now, for instance, January to April is the first bill, and then May to August, second bill. Even before the bill for the four-month period is received, the landlord is already charging its tenants. Is allowed. Must the landlord wait for the water bill for the past 4 years, for the past 4 months before collecting water charges from the tenants? Can there be advanced collection? Because even before I receive the water bill, I can ask my tenants to pay me at the rate of $15 or $20 per unit. This is one of the outrageous cases I've heard recently. So I'd like to know, when is the right time for a landlord to recover water charges from his tenants? You have a joint task force between the WSD and IRD. If someone has not produced a Form 2B, will you check on such cases as well? So in answering Mr. Chen Hockfeng's questions, the administration said that they will take the initiative to find or to look for SDUs. Will you only check on people who have submitted Form 2B, that is a tenancy agreement to you, or will you also check on premises that are highly suspicious to have SDUs set up? All right, you have only got 8 successful convictions among 92 complaints you have received. Have you checked on other irregularities? For instance, have they paid stamp duty for the tenancies? Have they complied with buildings ordinance, etc.? Mr. Yao, I thank Mr. Tang for his support of our proposal. Water charge is payable every 4 months. I understand that in the market, they may have their own water meter set up, and then they have a fixed rate per unit of water consumed. For us, the standard rate is $1.97 plus the sewage charges. If someone charges $2 per unit, that is already against the law. Now, it's risky for landlords not to have our own water meters. The best approach is for SDUs to have separate water charges. Now, the landlord may guesstimate the consumption, the water consumption for 1 or 2 months based on past consumption, but that can be risky. For our joint inspections, we focus on water-related facilities. We check tenancy agreements and water bills, and for contraventions of tenancy agreements, etc., they should be followed up by the IRD. Now, because we're not able to obtain documents from the relevant persons, we were not able to check whether there were other irregularities. Now, if we can have access to such documents, we will refer possible problematic cases to relevant departments. So even without any complaints, you will also take the initiative to inspect. I'd like to know whether you will only check those with registered tenancy agreements or otherwise. Well, we do not make a distinction. We will inspect complaint cases, and we will then check on the whole building instead. We will have no regard to whether there is a registered tenancy agreement or AL2. So it is against the law if there is no Form 2A registered. Secretary, so the question by Mr. Tang is, what bills are issued every 4 months? And what if the landlord charges its tenants every month? We have sought legal advice on this point. So long as there is no excessive charging, then it is not an offense and it may not be a matter we accord priority to. However, the proposed amendments here want to protect both the tenants and be fair to landlords. Right, in future, can a landlord charge his tenants water charges even before a water bill is received? Now, our legal team will study this issue and will see whether we should take this opportunity to amend the law at the same time. Thank you. Mr. Andrew Lam. Thank you. I'd like to follow up on the point made by Mr. Tang Kapiu. Because in reality, as mentioned by the Secretary, the landlord has to bear some risk because this is a gray area. For the new landlord and tenant consolidation ordinance, we give a tenancy safeguard for the tenant for up to 4 years, but there is no guarantee that the tenant will stay throughout the 4 year period. The tenancy may straddle 2 billing periods, so there is a gray area here. It is, of course, advisable to plug this loophole in this round of amendment. If you can't do that, I think you should publicize to SDU landlords and prospective LDU landlords the merits of having separate water meters for their SDUs. And I'd like to ask the administration about the promotion of automatic meter reading reporting so that you don't have to go into a unit to gather evidence. My understanding of the current proposal is that you do not just require evidence to be provided by the landlord. If need be, you can also ask tenants to provide information. I think you have to publicize this widely to tell tenants that it is better to lose their tenancy than to have breached the relevant ordinance. I don't want SDU tenants to be subject to unnecessary pressure, but then they should be informed that they are required to provide accurate information. I think you should publicize this point widely. All in all, I support the proposed amendments. Thank you. Mrs. Lin. Thank you. The question of tenants being under pressure. This is exactly why we want to amend the legislation. This is to give tenants a very legitimate reason to provide documents. Now they have been approached by the water authority. They have not taken the initiative to lodge a complaint. Anyone approached by the WA will have to provide the requested information. I hope this can address the concerns of tenants. As regards our automatic water consumption reporting, I defer to my colleague from the WSC. Thank you. Now for SDUs, perhaps the places are rather crowded and the water meter may not be in public areas, so we will have to go into the SDU in order to read the meter. The beauty of a smart water meter is we can note the water consumption remotely. We don't have to go into the SDU itself. Ms. Doreen Kong, I'd like to supplement on a point made by Mr. Tan Ka Piu. He said that water bills are issued every 4 months. Can the landlord charge water charges even before bill is received? Now, under Section 128AAZI, this is not allowed. This is in Section 120AAZI. The landlord has to pay the bill first and ask tenants to reimburse afterwards. So there is no need to amend the law. The LTC ordinance only regulates SDUs, but for the current proposed amendments, other units will also be covered. For SDUs under the current ordinance, under Section 120AAZM, if a landlord requires tenants to share the water bill, then there must be proof. And under Section 120AAZZD, the IRD is empowered to require tenants and landlord to provide requisition. So there is no need for the tenant to report a case to the WA. Under the current ordinance, the IRD can require the landlord and tenants to submit a proof of apportionment. And under Section 120AAZZD, it is said that such requisitions can be admissible as evidence in court. So if we read the current ordinance for tenant and landlord consolidation carefully, we will know that it is already rather comprehensive. Perhaps the problem lies with ineffective enforcement, so that we have to amend the Water Works Ordinance. In fact, under the LTCO, there is already sufficient power for the IRD to catch those landlords. Now we're talking about a few dozens of offenders. Why don't we ask the ILD to enforce the Landlord and Tenant Consolidation Ordinance? Now, upon passage of the bill, the first conviction will attract a fine of up to $10,000, and for second and subsequent convictions, $25,000. Now, if this doesn't serve a sufficient deterrent effect, why don't we raise the penalty levels? Can we raise the penalty level to $25,000 on first conviction and $50,000 on subsequent convictions? And for inadequate housing covering STU in the long run, can we require separate water meters as well as an electricity meter to be installed before and someone can operate an STU?
Secretary, can you tell us more on enforcement actions? Chairman? Well, on the Landlord and Tenant Consolidation Ordinance, Cap 7, there are indeed provisions regarding enforcement actions. Why are we proposing amendments for the Waterworks Ordinance? There are some considerations. We are not just covering SDU tenants. We are talking about people overcharging water charge. They do not have to be SDU tenants. That's the first point. And second, if we look at Cap 7, regulating the tenancy arrangements, the effective date is January of 2022. So for any tenancy agreements set up before January 2022, Cap 7 does not cover these tenancies. With the amendments of the Waterwork Ordinance, the date of the tenancy agreements does not matter. We have sought legal advice because currently we do have provisions in place and we do not have to take this extra step otherwise. And Ms. Kong asked whether or not we would undertake to ensure that all SDUs install separate water and electricity meters. Well, currently we can see that in certain SDUs, it is simply physically impossible to install separate water and electricity meters. And if we require tenants to install these meters, very often the landlords may pass the cost of it to the tenants. So are we really going to take this step? What we are trying to do is to enhance or strengthen enforcement actions to prevent disputes. And we want to let the public know that we do not tolerate any overcharging, since they have to present evidence if we approach them. And we want to encourage them to install these meters out of their own volition. How about penalty? Will you consider upping the penalty across the board? Chairman? Regarding the Waterworks Ordinance, we have worked with the Department of Justice and reviewed the provisions under the ordinance. And we feel that the current penalty level is appropriate. Let's say for some dozens of dollars of overcharged paid, then the penalty is $1,000. We think that this level is appropriate. As for Cap 7 or its penalty level, Chairman, I apologize, but this is not under the scope of the amendment of the Waterworks Ordinance, since the enforcement actions are mainly conducted by the RVD. Thank you. Next, Mr. Lewis Long. Chair, I support the amendments. I have two questions. First, regarding the installation of separate water meters. Technically speaking, places that is that are connected with the water network can separate water meters be installed there? That's my first question. Second, on the recommended increase of penalty. It is mentioned that the court may order any person convicted of water overcharging to repay to the payer the overcharged money. I would like to know what your considerations were. Is this to ensure justice, that people should be able to get back the money that they were overcharged? How come you use the word may but not must? Two questions. Thank you. Secretary, Chairman, I note Mr. Long's views regarding the choice of words, the use of may instead of must. I will follow that up with our legal team to see if we can make it sound more sure. Is there any legal considerations? I will take follow-up action on that. As for installation of separate water meters, there is indeed some technical consideration. I'll invite the Director of Water Supplies to respond. For most cases, when there are water pipes, water meters can be installed. But very often, we see that in SDUs, there is limited space. If the pipes are situated too close to the wall, then it may be difficult or not possible to install the water meter. And the second thing is that our colleagues will have to be able to conduct inspections there. But as I said, there may be locations where it is more challenging to install water meters. If that is the case, then we recommend using smart meters. Then we will be able to read the meters remotely. But in most cases, water meters can be installed. Thank you. Next, Mr. Lee Chun Kang. Thank you, Chair. I believe that many members agree with the intention of this amendment, that is to prevent landlords of SDUs from overcharging their tenants, especially when it comes to water charges. I do have a few questions. First, the administration talked about the use of smart water meters. If this is such a good measure, how come you are not promoting this to the public? First, you said that it can save space and it is effective. How come you are not promoting the use of smart water meters in enforcement actions? I've noticed that many other members have said that they appreciate the intention of the amendment, but how are you going to ensure effective enforcement actions if it is possible to install smart meters or flow meters to monitor the situations? If, let's say, for a certain unit, there is only one water meter, how come it is using so much water? Let's say for a 4-person household or 7-person household, you'll be able to get a grasp of the situation. That's my first question. Second, under CAP 102, Waterworks Ordinance, the initial fine is $25,000. And for any subsequent violation, then there is a further fine per day. However, for first conviction, the fine is only at $10,000. But for this case, if they are obtaining water illegally and they are selling water illegally, then it is comparable to what is mentioned in Cap 102. So should these two provisions be in line with one another? These are my two questions. Thank you. Director, I thank Mr. Lee for his support. We are currently conducting testing on the smart meters. We are selecting locations for the test. Currently, for the existing smart meters, we do have to read the meters in a close proximity. But what Mr. Lee has in mind is a remote reading that requires 4G or SIM cards. We are currently testing to identify the most cost-effective ways to transmit data. It's for Cap 102, Section 47. This is a much more serious offense. It is about connecting to the waterworks illegally. So in other words, stealing water without paying. So it is an illegal connection to the waterworks. And the most dangerous thing is that the public water source may be contaminated. That's why it is a more serious offense with a higher level of fine. Well, I don't really agree with you there. Of course, for people illegally obtaining water, it may be a source of contamination. But now we are talking about selling of water. This is also illegal activities. So to me, the penalty level should be comparable in order to achieve a deterrent effect. Thank you. Well, many members have touched upon the issue of the penalty levels. Secretary and Director, perhaps you can consider members' suggestions. And perhaps you can discuss this with the Department of Justice. Because the penalty level will have a significant impact on the effectiveness of the ordinance. Members have expressed their views and suggestions, which may help the government in considering all the amendments in the bill. If members have no other follow-up on this issue, then we conclude the discussion on this item. I thank the Secretary, Director, and their team for attending our meeting. Thank you. Now we will go to the next item. That is the progress report on implementation of funding scheme to support the use of vacant government sites by non-government organizations in the financial year 2022-23. I welcome the administration. Members who wish to speak, please press the request to speak button.
For this item, we have Ms. Doris Ho, Permanent Secretary for Development. Ms. Ingrid Yu, PAS, from the Development Bureau, as well as Ms. Sapphire Lo, Assistant Director from the Lands Department. PS,
Will you please introduce the paper to us before we go to the PowerPoint presentation? Yes, thank you. Thank you, Chair. We are grateful to the panel in allowing us time to report to you the progress of the $1 billion fund to support the use of vacant government sites by non-government organizations. The fund can be used for one-off expenses to make good use of our vacant government sites and to revitalize these premises as well. Members may recall that in 2019 January, the Finance Committee approved the $1 billion fund, and in February the same year, we launched the scheme. As shown on the slide here, it is a $1 billion fund to support NGOs to carry out basic works to revitalize vacant government sites or vacant school premises. We intend to capitalize on community wisdom. We will not dictate the use of the future use of the site. There should be proposals from NGOs to bring useful services to the community. And we would want to make the application and vetting procedures as simple as possible so that the projects can be commissioned earlier. And the scheme encourages tripartite collaboration of the government, NGOs, and professionals. The government provides the funding, the site, NGOs will be responsible for future services, and professionals. Now, some NGOs may not have expertise in project management, and so we will try to identify professionals to help NGO applicants to take forward their projects. Now, I will give the floor to my colleague Ingrid to give you the details of our scheme. We will also review on projects implemented and our future direction. Ms. Ingrid Yu, thank you. Referring to the PowerPoint, the Lands Department will consult government departments whether they have any use for vacant government sites or vacant school premises. Now, the departments may not have any use for these sites, but if they think that they have specific uses in the future, the site will be reserved for their use. If the vacant sites are not claimed by any department, they'll be released for NGOs to apply to use them on a short-term basis. Now, we have a geo info map for reference by NGOs. If an NGO is successful, then the district department will consult relevant bureau to see whether there is any policy support. If the answer is yes, then we will provide concession, and usually a short-term tenancy of up to 3 years will be granted, and special cases it can be up to 7 years. And we will provide subsidies for short-term projects during the use of the site. There are only two eligibility criteria. The NGO must have the support in principle for a short-term tenancy to be granted by the Lands Department, and the applicant must be either be a charitable organization under the Inland Revenue Ordinance or a social enterprise. The money can be spent on the following areas. For consultancy services, for instance, for detailed planning, site investigation, etc. they can be covered. And one of basic and essential restoration works can be covered. For instance, if the site is vacant with no structures and the NGO concerned has to erect temporary structures, then the funding scheme can support such expenses and also insurance payment for the works concerned. The ceiling for each project is $60 million. The NGO is responsible for commissioning consultants and contractors to carry out the works. And of course, the Development Bureau and professional government departments will provide professional input. For instance, if they have technical difficulties, they can consult us and we will liaise with government departments to help them to get the relevant approval. After we have received an application, we will have an interdepartmental assessment committee to assess applications. When documents are all ready, usually assessment can be done within 4 months. The purpose is to approve worthy projects as soon as possible so that they can proceed. Different aspects of work will be involved. To help them to proceed quickly, we will first approve the first stage funding funding requirement for site investigation and detailed design. And after that, they will be more certain about the project cost. They will have a better idea. And so at the second stage, we're going to approve the actual project costs. And after that, we have a monitoring system. First, they will have to sign the relevant STT with the Lands Department, and then a funding agreement will be signed with the Development Bureau. They will have to submit to us approved receipts and invoices, and we can give them reimbursement on a fully accountable basis. We've noticed that some NGOs may have cash flow difficulties, and yet we want projects to be implemented earlier. So if circumstances permit, we may allow cash advance so that projects can be done by stages. And after completion of a project, we will require a set of audited financial reports to ensure that the money has been spent properly. The scheme has been in place for a few years. We have approved about 25 projects. You can see on the map that those projects cover the whole territory. Now, to show you some major projects now, you can also refer to the annex for details. This is item 3 in Yuen Long. It is an animal boarding establishment in Cam Tin. It also offers animal adoption services. It started in operation in January last year. And again, another completed project at Tan Kwai village of Yuen Long. It is a community service center for ethnic minorities. It was commissioned in March. And this is item 7 of the annex. It's at a site at Harbor Quarry Bay Harbor Fund. It is an open recreation and sitting out area at the waterfront promenade. Community activities can be held here so that more members of the public can enjoy our waterfront. It started operation 2 weeks ago. And then we can look at some projects under construction. This is item 15 in Yunnan as well. We support an NGO to restore a vacant school premises to provide non-profit making education services for children with special needs. We expect that it can be commissioned in the fourth quarter of this year. This is item 16 in Sha Tin. It supports an NGO to use a vacant government site to set up a non-profit-making food production center to provide free lunch boxes and also food support to the needy. This is quite a large-scale project. It has got sponsorship from other organizations as well. Hopefully, it can be completed next year to start serving the community. So we have completed quite a number of projects in the past few years, and we have already approved $512 million. Hopefully, we can revitalize more sites, and so far, the scheme has received positive feedback, and we have received inquiries from NGOs hoping to apply for funding under the scheme so that they can provide services they plan for the public. So we will review our operational experience to see whether there is room for improvement, and we welcome suggestions from members as well. Thank you. Thank you. Now, members who intend to speak, we have six. I read out the names. Mr. Kenneth Lau, Ms. Chen Yu-ming, Mr. Michael Tian, Mr. Andrew Lam, Dr. Wendy Hong, and Ms. Louis Leung. 4 minutes each member, including questions and answers. Mr. Kenneth Lau, thank you. In 2019, the government launched the $1 billion funding scheme to support NGOs to make good use of vacant government sites. I'm all for this project. There are views that over $60 million a cap of $60 million per project is hardly sufficient for the works for revitalization of vacant school premises. In particular, $60 million is hardly enough, and smaller NGOs cannot afford to carry out any project. So can the government raise the cap and be flexible? As at end March, as mentioned, $512 million worth of projects have been approved, accounting for over half of the funding available. I urge the administration to review the effectiveness of the scheme as soon as possible to decide whether further injection is required, or will the scheme stop after the $1 billion has been depleted. According to the plan by the Lands Department, there are about 500 vacant government sites available for use. Most of them are in the NT. There are also vacant school premises. They are rather remote, and little interest has been shown to use the sites. I'd like to ask the administration whether the sites in the rural area can be made available for use by rural committees to promote rural culture and to provide welfare services for our villages. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Lau, for your comments. The first question is whether we will review the scheme. This is exactly what we plan to do. Hopefully, within this year, we can review the scheme. As pointed out by Mr. Lau, we've already committed over half of the money. We still have nine projects where the construction cost yet to be approved. There is only a very limited room to support new projects. As mentioned, this year is the right time to review the project. We're going to consider details of the project to see whether we need to relax some of the restrictions, such as the cap of $60 million. And the 25 projects already approved. For some, we have granted a few million dollars, some closer to $60 million. Experience tells us that for some projects involving vacant school premises and not accessible by roads, etc., well, they have to reconnect utilities supply, and therefore $60 million may not be sufficient. So we will review whether the $60 million cap is appropriate. And it's true that we should be flexible. There may be sites not accessible by roads, and it's too expensive to build a road. So for vacant government sites not accessible by roads, perhaps we should adjust the cap.
As for Mr. Lau's second question, on the GeoInfo map, there are some 500 pieces of land, government land, that is currently vacant. Well, I have to say that although only 25 projects were approved under this funding scheme, but in the past, 73 short-term tenancies were granted to NGOs. So that means that there are dozens of NGOs which did not apply for government's funding or subsidies to use these government vacant land. Compared with the previous 4 years, only 19 short-term tenancies were granted. So that is the difference between 73 and 19. It is quite a significant increase. Of course, there is always room for more. As for whether or not these vacant school premises can be rented to the rural committees, we are happy to consider this suggestion. If rural committees are interested in these pieces of land, they are more than welcome to contact us. Thank you. Next, Ms. Chen Yuming. Well, I support the government in the implementation of this funding scheme to support the use of vacant government sites by NGOs. These NGOs provide services that benefit the community. I have 2 points to make. In paragraph 8 to 9 in the paper, it is mentioned that the Interdepartmental Assessment Committee takes around 4 months on average to complete an assessment. However, I have been told by applicants that their applications were under assessment for over a year. This is mainly due to the fact that necessary information was not submitted on time. Similar questions or views have been expressed by other applicants. I hope that the administration can consider streamlining the assessment mechanism so that these projects can commence as soon as possible. Second, there are views in the community about relaxing the eligibility. As Mr. Kenneth Lau said, like rural committees or other organizations may want to apply for these sites, such as vacant school premises. I've noticed that there are quite a number of this type of land within recognized villages in the new territories. From the paper, it is mentioned that there were projects or applications that were rejected because of objections from the local community. Well, I would like to say that In these villages, the environment is usually very quiet, so villagers may have objections to these projects entering their villages. The administration should consider any impact on the security of these villages. I've also noticed that some of these sites are located within villages where there is no management committee. So I hope that you can introduce a mechanism that connects NGOs with the villages so that they can provide services that can benefit the community. This can ensure harmony in the community as well. Thank you. Permanent Secretary, I thank Ms. Chen for her comments. We endeavor to streamline the application procedures. We do not want these NGOs to go through different hurdles during the application process. So we do have a dedicated team in the Development Bureau to handle applications under this project, under this scheme. And they will act as a coordinator. And during the implementation of these projects, sometimes there is objection from the community. But we find that through communication, problems can be solved. If villagers are informed of the nature of these projects, and if compromises can be reached regarding the time of works, etc., we find that these issues can be resolved. And lastly, regarding village offices, whether or not they are eligible to apply for this funding, in our upcoming review, we will certainly consider your suggestion. Because currently, the organizations will have to be a charitable institution under the IRO. We will certainly consider your suggestion. Next, Mr. Michael Tian. Thank you, Chair. Well, there are in total 530 pieces of land available, and after 4 years of planning, 25 were approved. And there are 75 pieces of land granted to NGO on short-term tenancies. Well, regardless, there are still a few hundred vacant government land. Well, they may be places that are not that accessible. You can continue to wait to see if there are interested parties in the future. But it would be best if you can better utilize the land resources. Have you kept any record regarding any inquiries made of these sites? There are three major considerations. First, sites that may be irregular or with a small size that nobody is really interested in. Second, that piece of land may not be made ready with just $60 million. And the third type, transportation issues. Perhaps it is not accessible by car or by road, but will the government consider subsidizing infrastructure? This way you can revitalize these sites by providing road access. So among the remaining 400-odd sites, how many of them are quite irregular in shape? How many of them are left vacant because of the cost? And how many of them are because of lack of access? Well, we have conducted some preliminary analysis. The 25 projects approved, well, we have looked into the size required. We drew the line at 1,000 square meters. So out of the 25 projects, 70% of them require sites that are larger than 1,000 square meters. The remaining 30% below 1,000 square meters. So we have taken stock of our vacant land. We eliminate the vacant school premises. There are still some 460 sites left. If we look at their area or their size, 70% of them has a size of 1,000 square meters or below. So that means 100 for the remaining 100 over 1,000 square meters. You have made the right observation. They may be sitting idle for many years without any interested parties. You have made a suggestion. Perhaps if a government is to construct a road connecting different sites, but you do have sites that are larger than 1,000 square meters, right? Or can you look at them first? Well, they are more appealing to NGOs, those with larger sites areas. We can definitely do that. Well, regarding those 100 sites, how many of them can be connected through a road and revitalized? Can you look into that, and how long can you report back to us? When will the review be completed? Well, in the second half of this year, we will review the funding scheme. Perhaps we will review what you have suggested together as well. Well, the sites that with a area larger than 1,000 square meters, I would just like to get a rough estimate. Yes, we will do that in our review. So we'll see if we can report back to you by next year. Thank you. Next, Mr. Andrew Lam. I have to declare that the organization that I work with, SOCO, is also involved in the funding scheme. I believe that Mr. Michael Tan's suggestion does warrant further scrutiny. Well, in paragraph 6 to 7 in the paper, well, you are right in saying that for smaller NGOs or even larger NGOs, they may not be aware of or they may not be familiar with works process, and that the government will shoulder the consultant costs, and the costs will be dispersed or reimbursed by stages. I commend that. Some organizations are simply not familiar with construction projects. And in paragraph 7, it is mentioned that the government will provide technical advice to applicants to ensure the smooth completion of projects. Regarding different land sites, do you provide applicants with advice on, let's say, what types of consultants they have to engage? If they engage the wrong type of consultant, that may lead to cost issues and other problems as well.
The second point is whether $60 million is sufficient. Members mentioned that there should be flexibility. This point I agree, but I have seen many projects. I have directly or indirectly involved in many projects. Now, we are talking about temporary use. When people are asking for standards of temporary structures, is it really necessary? If it's just for temporary use, I'm not particularly targeting at this project. But in Hong Kong, our usual requirement is very high. Our standards are very high. For instance, of course, there must be electricity and water supply. And for building structures and fire safety considerations, they will check up the project costs very substantially. So we should consider being flexible when we are talking about temporary use. All right, temporary. How temporary? DPS. Thank you, Mr. Lam, for your views. For the first point, it's fine. As mentioned, the Development Bureau has a dedicated team to consider such projects. If NGOs wish to have departmental views at the very initial stage, the Development Bureau can assist. The second question is, how temporary, how short-term is the short-term tenancies? Using the 25 projects as an example, the first STT is in the region of 3 or 5 or 6 years. After the first term, renewal will be usually on a quarterly basis. If the site has not long-term use earmarked for it, while we call it a short-term tenancy, the NGO can expect to use the site for quite a long time. Mr. Lam queried whether our standards can be appropriately reduced. Perhaps we don't need to apply so-called golden rules for the facilities. We do understand, after all, we are talking about public money. We will be flexible as far as possible. Now, some my colleagues have told me that usually they want universal access facilities, barrier-free access, but if it is very expensive and there are levels that persons with disabilities need not access. For instance, the first and second floor can be used for offices and only the ground floor is open to the public, then we may be able to do away with barrier-free access. We'll bear this in mind. We ensure that we are not asking for an ultra-high standard. We do understand that we are spending public money and we have to strike a balance. Dr. Wendy Hong. Thank you, Chair. I welcome the funding scheme so that vacant government sites can be used. According to information, there are over 200 vacant government school premises, half of which are with no planned purpose. And some of them are in urban areas and they've been left vacant for a long time without any use. Now, if they're not taken back by the government, then they cannot be incorporated into the scheme. My question for the Lands Department is whether you can expedite the redevelopment of old school premises so that in sites near the urban areas, they can be used for community purpose. And according to the paper, 25 projects are interim housing at Mount Davis, $750,000 will be used to convert government quarters to interim housing. I'd like to know how long will such a project last, because it will provide 11 1P unit. That means $73,000 per unit. How long can it last? Is it really too expensive? And item 8 and 9. 8. Transitional housing at Kwai Chung. So the preliminary work has got funding approved, $2.9 million. I have checked against the housing department's building costs. I think this is just for consultancy. The actual building cost will be $5 million approved by the Finance Committee in 2020. In other words, for this scheme, two batches of money have been approved. One for consultancy service, second for construction. I'd like to know whether there is any duplication and whether the money is being well spent. P.S. Thank you, Dr. Ho, for your question. You talked about 200-odd vacant school premises. I think that is under the central allocation system run by the planning department. Now, under the current mechanism, once school premises are no longer needed by the Education Bureau, they will be returned to the planning department. And then the planning department will consider the long-term use of these sites, some of which can be used for housing purpose, some should be kept as GIC sites. If my memory serves me, for the 250-odd school vacant school premises, they have been reviewed in the past few years. Some have been used for housing, and some have to be kept GIC zones. If they are available for short-term use by NGOs in a form of STT, we are talking about 40-odd. They have already been in the geo-informed map run by the Lands Department. So if those in the 200-odd vacant school premises can be used by NGOs in the form of STT, they are already known to potential users. We have 40-odd of them. Dr. Hong also asked about the site at Victoria Road, Mount Davis, a transitional housing being operated by SOCO. How long can the project last? For the first, STT is 5 years. It can be renewed on a quarterly basis. There is no long-term use identified for the site. Since there is no long-term use identified, the user, it appears that the user can use the site indefinitely. Dr. Hong also asked about the two transitional housing projects in Chun Wan and Kwai Chung. Under the funding scheme, indeed, money can be provided for site investigation, for detailed design, and for consultancy services. There is a dedicated fund for transitional housing to cover the construction costs, so there is no duplication of the two funds. The reason why the NGO has applied for funding support under our scheme is because the task force on transitional housing was set up later than ours. So they came to us for advanced funding support of preliminary work, and then when they start construction, they will go to that fund for support. Mr. Louis Leung, given that we are so short of land in Hong Kong,
it is good that we have a funding scheme to facilitate the use of vacant government sites by NGOs with a $1 billion fund set up to help them. I support this. But then, looking at it from my own profession, these sites are let to NGOs in the form of short-term tenancies, and the term can only be up to 7 years. For many of the projects here, they involve rather massive development. Even you allowed the NGO to use the site, you provide a support of $60 million. Huge investment is still required. Take item 16 as an example. Non-profit making food production center to be set up in Sha Tin. There will be a sorting area, production area, activity areas, etc. $60 million is just peanuts when it comes to the total cost. The STT will only last for 4 years, 9 months. Assuming that the funding agreement was signed in April 2020, the STT will end in December 2026. However, the project can only be completed in the fourth quarter of 2024. In other words, the NGO can only use the site for 2 years with security of tenure. Of course, there can be quarterly renewal afterwards, but from my perspective as someone in the real estate trade, I wonder why NGOs are willing to accept this. Do you have any comfort for them? That is, there can be certain period of renewal guaranteed after the STT has expired. Yes, judging from the design plan you have here, the facility will be used for a long time. I think Mr. Leung knows our current policy well. Under our SCT mechanism, the term can only be up to 7 years, after which renewal is on a quarterly basis. But we have many cases where the actual term is much longer than 7 years because renewal can be given on a quarter-by-quarter basis. If you ask us, what sort of comfort can we offer to NGOs? Now, at present, we do not envisage any long-term use for this site, and that's the case for many vacant government sites. And so NGOs will know how to work it out. For instance, if they have less than 7 years, and if there is no long-term use for the site for the time being, NGOs will consider whether having taken into account the project time, the construction time, and the amount of subsidy from the government, whether they should proceed with the project or not. Food Angel, in fact, has only got a portion of its subsidy from the government. A larger part of its funding has come from outside organizations. It's true that a longer tenure can give more guarantee. We've already given the message to the NGO that there is no long-term use for the site for the time being. So if they so wish, they can continue to use the site. Mr. Leung, usually the government is on the conservative side. As mentioned, they could have given a longer term instead of 4.5 years. It can be 7 years. But this is indeed quite interesting. And a supplement from you, Mr. Leung, a very quick follow-up.
Item 16. You mentioned that the OZP zoning is village type development. Will you help them or providing assistance in rezoning for the site?
Permanent Secretary. Well, I was reminded by the Secretary. I thought our meeting would last until 5:30, but it is 5:15, so I'll extend the meeting. Perhaps I'll invite my colleague Ingrid to take this question. Thank you. Regarding the temporary use, if the site is being used for any temporary use, they do not have to apply for any changes in the OZP. Since it is being used for temporary purposes. But if they wish to continue to use this piece of land for the long run, then they need to make an application to change the land use in the OZP. Well, that would entail a lot of investment. Well, all members have spoken on this. I thank the administration for attending the meeting. Our next item, any other business? We have none. Meeting adjourned. Thank you.